Zapraszam do zajęcia miejsc. Please take your seats because we are about to have a very pleasant moment. Zapraszam do zajęcia miejsc. Takie konferencje to nie tylko jest okazja, żeby spotkać kolegów z bardzo wielu różnych krajów i wypić z nimi kawę i posłuchać ciekawych referatów, ale jest to także dobra okazja, żeby uczcić osoby szczególnie zasłużone dla naszego pola badań. Nie będę wyjawiał jeszcze, o kogo chodzi, ale oddam głos profesorowi Rossmanowi, który to wszystko wyjaśni. Profesor Rossman, bardzo proszę.
In 1991, Władysław Bartoszewski and Antoni Polonsky modestly titled their book, The Jews in Warsaw. But then they wrote a masterful introductory essay and anthologized papers, which together demonstrated how much the Jews were actually of Warsaw. Warsaw, the Jewish metropolis, begins with a bold assertion that Warsaw, or at least a big part of it, was a veritable Jewish city. The editors of the volume based their claim on two fundamental parameters, size and variety. For about 100 years, Warsaw contained the largest Jewish community in Europe, and before the First World War, the largest Jewish community in the world. And it also housed a dizzying diversity of Jewish expression. Riffing perhaps on Doris Goodwin's description of Abraham Lincoln's cabinet as a team of rivals, Diner and Genet speak of Jewish Warsaw as a community of opposites. The articles gathered here show how an invisible cultural hand wove the variegated strands of Warsaw Jewry throughout the generations into an integral whole. They also show how complicated the relationship between the Jewish metropolis and the larger metropolis was, combining social alienation with symbiosis and even occasionally impressive cooperation. Even more complicated was the Jewish community itself. On the most apparent level, it was a community riven by political strife, Kulturkampf, between Zionists, socialists, communists, religionists, Yiddishists, Hebraists, assimilationists, etc. What this book proves is how much these opposing camps were actually facets of a rich, creative, and dynamic heritage, enabling Jews of all types to express their identity and participate in the community. In the final analysis, what counted was not divisiveness, but mutual accommodation and fundamental interconnectedness. What stands out is the strength of communal institutions, whether charitable, political, economic, educational, cultural, athletic, literary, journalistic. This heritage continued to resonate even if the community itself no longer existed, even in the most dire of circumstances. It has proven strong enough to outlast the vicissitudes of history and survive in a new, different incarnation symbolized by this museum. Warsaw, the Jewish metropolis, is very much a reflection of the scholar whom it honors. Within his very person, one can detect the many strands of Warsaw Jewry coexisting in a felicitous balance. Like these essays, Antoni Polonsky has a great knack for clearly explaining complexities while revealing the complexity behind the deceptively simple. A scholar for whom, as this book says, context is everything, his own chronicling of Warsaw Jewry provides the context for the studies presented here to Antoni. Happy birthday.
Thank you so much, Moshe. We really appreciate it. This project began, as all big projects begin, over coffee. Francois and I sat down after an interesting session he had just presided over, dealing with the question of really cosmopolitanism, but also of metropolis. And I invited him for coffee after the session, and we began to think about broader issues of Polish-Jewish history. We noticed, we'd certainly been trained by Professor Polanski to think in terms of why Jews had failed to become Poles of the Mosaic persuasion, the failure of integration, and of course, the exceptions to that rule, those Jews who did integrate. And we were thinking, what would happen if we flipped the question and almost did a photo negative in the sense of looking at, okay, so those who did not choose integration, what happens if we follow those pathways into the new Jewish politics or anti-modern movements like Hasidism, Yiddishist movements, and so on. And we arrived immediately at Warsaw as the logical setting, as the ideal setting to study these phenomena, because it's just so diverse, you know. And very quickly after that, we arrived at the ideal person to dedicate such a imagined volume to, and that, of course, is Antoni Polanski, whom we feel so indebted to, because he created this enormous platform upon which we can explore Polish-Jewish history in a way that was just so healthy and so new, relatively devoid of acrimony, of accusations and apologetics, and so on. But before I get down off this podium, I have to ask that those who contributed to this volume please stand up to be recognized, because along the way, when we started receiving the articles that followed the initial conference, I think our hearts began to leap. These were some of the most fantastic contributions, just exceeding our expectations, and we were just so gratified. So please, those who participated. And now Francois will say a few words.
I will add just a very few words. In the earlier session about the 19th century, there was a reflection about the danger of Warszawa centrynność, Warsaw centrism. I mean, if you imagine a museum about American Jewry and New York would feature very prominently, I wonder whether people would be worried about New York centralism. So this dynamic that Warsaw is also an obvious major center of modern Jewish culture, that it has been denied this position is in a certain way also a reflection of its metropolitan character, because so many people would lay claim to the various cultural identifications which were produced and transformed in Warsaw, that Warsaw itself somehow dissolved into thin air, not in the least, obviously, to the tragedy of the 20th century and the Holocaust, but also because there was so much competition for the honor involved in Zionism, Hasidut, and all the other identifications, which are actually discussed in this volume. I have to add a couple of expressions of thankfulness to the sponsors of the regional conference, which was the Fondation pour la Mémoire de la Shoah in Paris and the Institute for Jewish Studies at UCL, and who else? The museum was involved. We had a session about the museum, and what we heard about the museum, we had a session where we discussed the project. I mean, that's 5 years ago, and it's quite amazing to see what happened over these 5 years. What was discussed 5 years ago in London has nothing to do with what we are seeing today here. So the session in London at the conference honoring Antony is was itself or is itself an example of how intense the work has been in creating this museum, and is extremely, extremely impressive, and impressive because it's also indicative for what Warsaw stands for, which is cultural, political, societal dynamism. So it is Glenn's and my great joy to hand over the volume today to Antony.
Ladies and gentlemen, obviously this is a very moving moment. I'm extremely grateful to François and to Glenn, to Moshe Rossman for his kind words, to all those who contributed to this volume. It's well known that one is above all known for one's students, as Pirkei Avot, and Glenn is one of my students. François is a co-editor with me, co-chairman of the Editorial Collegium of Poland. This is a family gathering, and I'm very grateful for this volume, which I very much look forward to reading. I've already read a couple of the articles, which are on Academia EDU, but I wanted to wait to have the volume, and I'm very grateful. Warsaw is very dear to my heart. It's dear to my heart partly for the reasons that Moshe already articulated. This was a great Jewish metropolis. There is still Jewish life here. This is still, I think, the major center of Jewish life in Poland. And this museum is built in the heart of the Northern District of Warsaw, where most Jews lived. And it is a posthumous integration of Jews into the life of Warsaw and into the life of Poland. The volume which Moshe talked about starts with the sentence that at the center of the story lies a tragic failure, that is the failure to integrate Polish Jews. That circle has now been closed. But that's not the only reason why Warsaw is dear to me. There are many other cities in Poland which are more beautiful than Warsaw, or were in Poland. Krakow, Vilnius, Lviv. But what marks Warsaw is its vitality and its ability to rise from tragedy. This is a city which was 90% destroyed, and yet it's a vibrant town today. Many of the old parts have been rebuilt. I regret that some of the Victorian parts, including the Kronenberg Palace, have not been rebuilt. I regret also that some of the buildings which we liked from the communist period, in particular, Super Sam and the old airport building, have also gone the way of all flesh. But this is a vibrant European capital of 2 million people, and it is indomitable, as is shown by the symbol of the Sirena. And not only that, this was the place where I first came to Poland, where I first encountered Poland, where I came to understand why my political views were naive and why one needed a democratic and pluralistic system in this country and in the whole of this part of Europe, which we see today. So Warsaw is for me the center of Polish life and the town with which I feel most affinity in this country, in spite of the many other beautiful places where I've spent time here and which I'm also attracted to. And so I'm very glad to have this volume, and I thank again the editors for giving it to me. Thank you. We should now move on to the next session, which I am actually the chairman of, so I'd very much ask those people who are going to participate in this session to come up to the platform. Well, ladies and gentlemen, I think we should start quite straight away, because this is a big session, and this is an important session, because when we think about the publication of the material that we are of this conference, the first part of that is the historiographic aspect. The lecture which Barbara Kirschenblatt-Gimblett gave yesterday, describing the way in which the museum was put together, the lecture by Moshe Rossman describing the evolution of Polish Jewish historiography, and the way in which the people at this panel, all of whom have been involved in museums in various places, see the role of the historian in the museum. So this is a very important session, and in planning it, I was probably a little overambitious because, as you see, I've had to put two more chairs at this table. There are seven of us, and so we have a relatively limited time, and I will appeal to people to try and keep their remarks relatively brief, although I do appreciate that there's only, that brevity, although it's the soul of wit, is not always easy to achieve. I'm reminded of the man at the Zionist Congress who got up on the platform and started speaking and was told he had 20 minutes, and at the end of 20 minutes he went on speaking, and the person passed up to him the little piece of paper which we have here saying 5 minutes, and he nodded his head, and he went on for another 10 minutes. Again, he was given the 5 minutes, he nodded his head, and then at the end, the man who was in the chair went up and said, "Mr. Rabinowitz, you have to stop now." He said, "I know, but how?" So I hope people will find how, and I'll introduce the people very briefly as they speak, and the first of them is Jonathan Brent, formerly a leading editor at Yale University Press, responsible for some very important books on Soviet politics appearing available to the English public, and himself also a major author, now the director of YIVO in New York, one of the major museums and scholarly institutions within the Jewish world. John.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you to all the organizers. Thank you to Barbara Kirschenblatt-Gimblett for inviting me and for including YIVO in this very important event. Having listened to the presentations of the last 2 days, I find that I have to, with apologies to the translators, I have to diverge a little bit from my prepared talk, though I hope I'll be able to find a way of stopping on time. I was particularly struck by what various people referred to as the narrative of Jewish history, and the YIVO Institute is very much involved in trying to help shape such a narrative in the United States. Couple years ago, Philip Roth, the author of Portnoy's Complaint and many other great novels, often considered one of the most important American Jewish writers of the 20th century, gave a talk at YIVO, and to thank him, I sent him the 2-volume encyclopedia of Jews of Eastern Europe that YIVO had published from Yale University Press, I'm proud to say, some years before. I then called him up a couple days later to see how he was doing and if he had gotten the gift. And he said, "Jonathan, it's so interesting that you call me right now." I said, "Why?" He said, "Well, I'm sitting here with your encyclopedia and I'm reading it." I said, "Philip, why on God's earth are you reading my encyclopedia? I sent it to you as a present to thank you, but I surely didn't expect you to be reading it." He said, "Well, I used to think I was born in Newark," which is where he was born. And then he said, "But now I see it's a much bigger story." And this is a very, very interesting thing coming from someone like Philip Roth, who has kept the Jewish world in a sort of ambivalent arm's length for many, many, many years. And so it's that bigger story that I want to address a little bit. YIVO was founded in 1925 in Vilna, as many of you know, but since 1940, its home has been New York City. And this fact of both displacement and renewal inevitably shapes the conditions in which YIVO understands its mission as both a scholarly and a communal organization. With over 23 million primary source documents and artifacts, and a library of some 400,000 volumes, the largest collection of Yiddish writing in the world, YIVO has one of the largest collections in the world of East European Jewish primary materials. And today, despite the growth of Jewish studies departments and the work of so many fine scholars, many of whom are in this room. The American diaspora, however, is still very much as Max Weinreich found it in 1940, largely beset by ignorance, indifference, and fragmentation, which threaten it every bit as much as anti-Semitism, and perhaps even more so. It is at least partially in light of this that we must see our efforts today in the sphere of Polish-Jewish studies. The integration and dissemination of information is fundamental to what we do, but information by itself is not enough. The American experience for the majority of East European and Russian Jews has necessarily been one of basic historical disruption. What is our relationship to our European past? How can that relationship continue? Does it, should it continue? Are we in a new historical period? In some sense, American popular culture and 75 years of Soviet repression produced similar kinds of erasures and dissolutions, which have led to the fragmentation of Jewish life in the diaspora and the loss or confusion of historical consciousness, a void inevitably filled with deadening cliches, stereotypes, and kitsch that will doom Jewish culture to one-dimensionality or hype, the very thing this museum has set itself to oppose. Historical knowledge, however, is not simply a matter of documents, so-called facts, or data, of knowing where your grandparents lived or when precisely they set foot on Ellis Island. It is a matter of interpretation and meaning. One relevant interpretation of the meaning of modern Jewish experience that is indeed relevant to the U.S. diaspora is provided by Anski, author of the Dybbuk, in his powerful description not just of the danger faced by individual Jews, but by Jewish life after a devastating pogrom in 1916, which he describes in the destruction of Galicia. As we turned to go, we saw a fantastic sight. Hundreds of tall stones, red and glowing, with flaming Jewish letters on them, appeared in the distance. At first, I didn't see what it was, and then I realized that we were looking at a Jewish cemetery. The burning flames were reflected on the headstones, making them look as if they were on fire. It was an extraordinary sight. Generation upon generation appeared to have come out on this mystic night of the full moon to gaze with fiery looks at the horror that was all around and that was fast approaching the spot. The past, as well as the present, is on fire for Anski. In the Dybbuk, which he was writing at about the same time, he takes this theme a step further. When informed that the father of the bride, who is possessed by the Dybbuk, has come to beg his services, Reb Azriel reflects, to me? How could he have come to me when the me in me is no longer here? His assistant, Michoel, says, Rebbe, everyone in the world comes to you. Indeed, everyone in the world seems to have been drawn into this whirlpool. When the master narrative has gone up in flames and the words have been erased by fire from the tablets, individual identity becomes groundless. How can we understand our place in the world when the me in me is no longer here? In his 1920 diary, Isaac Babel witnesses a similar erasure in the destroyed synagogues of Dubno and reflects, you have to have the soul of a Jew to sense what it means. But what does the soul consist in? Can it be that ours is the century in which they perish? 13 years before Hitler seizes power and 20 years before the Holocaust, in the midst of the ruins of Dubno, Babel contemplates the perishing of his people. Babel creates an image of this catastrophe in the first story of his collection, Red Cavalry, which began to be serialized just about the time of Ivo's own birth in 1925. And I would like to think about this image a moment because it comes before World War II. And I think it is relevant to the Jewish future in Poland, in Russia, and also in the United States. The Red Army must cross the Zbruch. The river rages. The majestic moon lies on the waves. Horses, men, carts are swept along by the powerful current. Rumbling, whistles, songs, quote, thundered over the moon serpents and the shining hollows. After their crossing, the narrator is billeted to the house of a pregnant Jewish woman. He finds a disgusting mess, broken cupboards, scraps of a woman's fur coat, human excrement, and, quote, fragments of the secret plate they used once a year by Jews on Pascha, a word that means both Passover and Easter. One might think it should surely be rendered Passover here, but perhaps Babel's ambiguity is intentional, as his narrator presents himself not as a sympathetic Jew, but as a Cossack recruit, and harshly tells the woman to clean up the mess. This shattered representation of the Jewish story of the Exodus from Egypt, the crossing of the Red Sea, coming after Babel's regiment crosses the river's brook, may help us understand the moon's serpent in the hollows of the waves a bit better. In the Passover story, the Israelites safely cross the Red Sea, while Pharaoh's army drowns. In Babel's text, indeed, one man sinks, but the rest make it to safety. Is this the army of Moses, or is this the army of Pharaoh? And if the army of Pharaoh, now successfully across the river, then the ancient mythological Jewish paradigm of national salvation and identity lies smashed as that plate in the woman's house in the ruins of history, impossible to reconstruct. Can it be that the Egyptians have finally prevailed? The horse and his rider are thrown into the sea. The Lord is my strength, my might, writes the biblical text in Exodus. The word sea is yam in Hebrew. But in Babel's Russian, yam is the genitive plural of yama, used in the passage I quoted. And these are the hollows into which the serpents of the moon dart and slide. The yam of the Hebrew and the yam of the Russian experience meet here in this narrative of destruction. Fluent in both Hebrew and Yiddish, Babel certainly would have known the biblical text. The hollows of the river, the silence inside the thundering, contains the empty space in which a Russian and Jewish identity struggle with each other after the smashing of the mythological Jewish paradigm of liberation and selfhood. The creation of the State of Israel in 1948, to some extent, provided Jewish life with a new historical narrative. But what of Anski's me, the homeless dibbuk of Jewish identity? Later in the story, Babel's narrator comes upon a dead Jew whose face has literally been split in two by the poles. Blue blood lay in his beard like a piece of lead. The word for lead in Russian is svinets, which is closely associated with the word for the word pig, svinya. As if from his own divided self, the blood poured out and congealed in the dead Jew's beard like a lump of forbidden food he himself had vomited up. His own blood becomes his negation. The story ends in silence as the narrator cannot respond to the fury of the pregnant woman's hidden accusation when she asks, "Where in the entire world can you find another father like my father?" And it is as if language itself has become the medium of desecration, echoing Kafka's own reflections in his diaries. The Jews of Eastern Europe and Russia crossed another sea to get to America, but the yam of that sea and the yam of Babel's hollows remain with many of us today. I have cited all this at more length than perhaps I should, because I want to suggest that the work we are engaged in is more than simply processing, digitizing, and publishing archives or books, as complicated, difficult, and urgent as that might be. It is a matter of dealing with a radical rupture in the master historical narrative of the Jewish people that is felt by writers such as Anski and Babel before the Holocaust. The goal of developing an integrated historical consciousness cannot be achieved by one institution working alone, and it cannot be achieved quickly or cheaply. There are no simple solutions or certainties of success developing partnerships such as the one we have with Pauline, but also with other Jewish and non-Jewish organizations in Israel, America, Russia, and elsewhere in Eastern Europe is an important first step. As part of this, YIVO wishes to develop programs to reconnect archival collections split up by the Holocaust or other exigencies. A joint project with ERGASPI, the former Central Party Archive, for instance, in Moscow, to digitally integrate their fragment of the Bund archive with YIVO's much larger collection in a single web portal, or reuniting the precious Onsky materials held in the Vernadsky Library in Kiev, at YIVO and the Ethnographic Museum in St. Petersburg are obvious examples. YIVO is now in the midst of preparing numerous shared programs with the Lithuanian Jewish community in Vilnius, the most important of which is the very ambitious 7-year project to reintegrate digitally all of YIVO's pre-war archives and library that was torn apart by the Nazis. Other partners to this project include the National Library of Israel in Yad Vashem. Part of this collection is in New York, part still resides in Vilnius. Over the past 3 years, YIVO has worked against much opposition, and I should add largely from Jewish quarters, to develop this project with the Lithuanian National Library and the Lithuanian State Archive to process, conserve, and digitize over 1.5 million documents, perhaps as many as 2 million documents, and some 10,000 books. The project will reunite the fragments of the famed Strashun Library, completely digitize YIVO's collection of pre-war Yiddish language books, the largest collection in the world, and reunite digitally the two halves of YIVO's broken collection. It is truly a matter of finding the Afikomen. Highlights of the project include the papers of Shimon Dubnov, the Esther Rochel Kaminska Theater Museum collection, the Elias Cherikover archives, Yiddish manuscripts, materials from over 200 Jewish communities in Poland, Russia, and Soviet documents from 1845 to the 1930s, music for about 450 operas, operettas, and vaudeville acts, and the Vad HaYeshivot records, a network of 70 yeshivot in the 5 eastern provinces of Poland. Building a proper structure for necessary programs of preservation, research, and education capable of global outreach will require the partnership of enlightened philanthropy, far-sighted organizational management, scholarship, and the goodwill of institutions, both Jewish and non-Jewish, throughout the world. Very little of contemporary East European and Russian diaspora still speaks Yiddish, the language in which so great a percentage of YIVO's documents were written. Therefore, translation is essential, both into English, but also into other languages. But what is more, a new generation of translators and archivists needs to be developed to understand not only the Yiddish language, but Yiddish culture as well. This is an enormous undertaking. Today, there is no center for advanced Yiddish studies in the United States where translators and scholars can be taught. And the 1,000-year history of East European and Russian Jewry is often relegated to one or two disconnected classes from which it is impossible to form a well-rounded or complex understanding. Therefore, advanced educational programs must be developed, staffed, and funded. The YIVO project in New York and Vilnius is essential, but only a beginning. Without it and other projects like it, we will never be able to engage that bigger story that Philip Roth referred to. And now I want to show a couple images about YIVO. This is the original building as it was in 1935. You can see real scholarly academic work went on of all sorts. This is Kaczerginski and Sutzkever sorting books for the Nazis before the books were then taken to the loading dock and put on trains coming to Frankfurt, Offenbach, Germany, where the US Army found a lot of this material after the war. This is the YIVO building after, and that's Sutzkever, who came back to Vilnius in 1944 in order to dig up the vast amount of material that he had buried and which lay under the rubble. And this is the erasure. That's where the YIVO building was. It's now an empty space. It's an empty space in not just Vilnius, but in the consciousness of the people. I gave a lecture in Vilnius not long ago, and a young woman came up to me in tears, and I said, "Why are you crying?" And she said, well, I must apologize. I said, why? You're not guilty of anything. She said, no, no, I was born here in Vilnius and I never knew that Jews lived here. These are the materials that were sent back by the US Army. That's Suchgever and Katraginsky collecting stuff. Here's some of it. And these are some of the materials that we found in unsorted boxes still in Vilnius. This is actually a document from the Einsatzstab Rosenberg. This is a conduct book. And this is the condition that most of the material is in. Still, now, you unpack these things and the dust of the ghetto falls out of them.
Where was it until now?
Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Jonathan, for this moving account. One of the things that we had in mind when we created this particular panel was our desire to stress our wish at this museum to work with everybody else in this field. The one thing that we are above all against is chauvinism, and particularly institutional chauvinism. And this is a very difficult task, as you have described, and one which we all need to work on, and which transcends national boundaries as well as ethnic and religious divisions. And the second speaker is Edita Gavron, who is the director of the Center for the Study of the History of the Jews in Krakow at the Jagiellonian University. She's written extensively on this topic and in particular on the history of Jews in post-war Krakow. She's also one of the principal consultants of the museum, which is housed in the former factory which was taken over by Schindler during the Second World War and which is one of the most successful museums in Krakow, Edita.
Thank you, Anthony. Thank you for the introduction and inviting me to this panel. It's a pleasure to talk at such important conference, but it's also a pleasure to share some experience of the work between the university and the museum. And when I was to choose the title, I was a little bit egocentric. I referred to my experience of moving from the university to the museum, or I should rather say in plural, to the museums, because beside working on the museum in Schindler's factory, I'm also involved in a Galicia Jewish Museum, which is much closer to the Institute of Jewish Study of Jewish Studies at the Jagiellonian University, which is my primary location in Kazimierz. So I would like to share some reflections on the experience of as a historian in the museum, and how it could be shown based on the example of Schindler's factory, working on the museum in Schindler's factory, and I will try to compare it to the other types of experience on working on the exhibitions, both permanent and temporary exhibitions in private and state museums, which also is different in Poland, and it's worth to be mentioned here in such a place. I'm of a very strong belief that working as a historian, we have to keep in mind the audience, not only the audience of the academic books and scholarship, but also the wider audience, and to share this experience. And the museums, working with the museums, it's the opportunity. Barbara Kirschenblatt-Gimblett yesterday focused on the numbers, how many people read academic books and how many people visit the exhibitions, and I think we need to keep it in mind when we work. So working on the various museums, but in particular on the museum in Schindler's factory, as a historian, I experienced different challenges. Challenge of keeping to high academic standards and using them in the concept of the exhibitions, providing the expertise in authenticity of the artifacts and collections there, but also transferring the knowledge into visual form, keeping in mind the education, keeping in mind different groups of potential visitors. And when thinking about the presentation today, I decided to divide it into three levels, before, during, and after. Before working on the exhibition, as a historian, during the process of creating the exhibition, and the follow-up, the after period. And first of all, hearing about the museum here, about Pauline, I could refer to the same stages of master plan and other stages that were mentioned yesterday. And I would like to show the example of Schindler's Factory and focus on some elements that haven't been mentioned yesterday. Could we change the... working on the exhibition in Schindler's Factory, we have experience, by the way, I had to mention that I worked with, as a member of the team of five people of different background, and I was the only historian from the university, so it was a special experience. Working on this particular museum, we had to keep in mind several factors, existing and planned infrastructure, as it was mentioned in case of Pauline, but also the structure of the wider museum that already was in operation, which was the Historical Museum of the City of Krakow, and its plan of having the road of memory, the trail of memory, memory trail, consisting of three parts, and Schindler's Factory was one of them. This place, this particular place, also had this... challenge of being a legend, being a landmark, and being the theme of the very famous book and movie. And we had to deal with popular history, as we call it, and try to combine the popular history with real history, academic history, as we name it. We working on this particular museum, we had to keep in mind the other elements, the other places located within the Historical Museum of the City of Krakow, which is the museum in Pomorska, Pomorska Street, and also the museum in the pharmacy, Eagle Pharmacy in Krakow's ghetto. So to plan the structure of the museum, we had to keep in mind what's in the other branches, but also what will be there. Not enough challenges, we had to face political challenge, as we call it. Of course, before we were invited to work in the museum, the local politicians already knew what should be shown there. And the meetings with the politicians were one of the most interesting experience. As a historian, and as the representative, in this case, of the Jagiellonian University local academic authority, I had to say no to all the three proposals given by the local politicians. And the team, of course, supported this decision, and we came up with the idea of showing the story that is the story of Krakow, the city under Nazi occupation, instead of creating Holocaust Museum, creating the Museum of Oskar Schindler, or creating the Museum of Polish Righteous Among the Nations. The location was very, very special, but also the time and resources, financial side of this was very limited. And initially we were given 3 years, and we kept the time. Between the first meeting on the museum and the opening, the time was less than 3 years. So it gives you some idea of the time pressure and also the devotion of the team and the local historians in this project. The concept that we worked on had to be clear, simple, and include the narrative of the local people, but also include the Jewish history. And differently than Pauline, this museum was the museum of the city that had to include Jewish history. So it was the museum were part, only a part was about the Jews, about the Jewish history. But we had the goal that was to incorporate Jewish history into the wider history, into the history of the city, and to offer this context to the thousands of visitors coming to Krakow and learning only the separate parts of the history and not having the wider picture, for example, of the Second World War experience in Krakow, but seeing only the parts of the history. So defining the goals, defining the audience, but also working on different levels. And this is something that combines the academic knowledge and the visual element of the museum. It was repeated several times yesterday that we work with some images, and images can say, in many cases, more than any academic work. But we need academic work in order to choose images, in order to describe them, and in order to provide the context to these images. And that's why this particular museum was designed on three levels. The first one, very visual, only images. The second one included some results of academic research. And for those who represented the higher level of the academic knowledge or just interest in academic knowledge, they can get deeper into the multimedia presentations. And this level, the third level, includes the biggest parts of academic work of our historical research. And working on the exhibition, we had to, as the team, we had to follow the line that is quite popular in today's American pop culture that sounds, curb your enthusiasm. You can show a lot, but you cannot show all. You cannot show all what you've learned in the archive. We cannot show everything that we found during our academic research. We have to select. So curb your enthusiasm when you have the tools to get to the audience. And also, we had to be very limited when it comes to the space, because the museum was created in the existing building that was very long and very narrow. It had three levels, and we couldn't change the structure of the building. So it was very challenging to incorporate all the knowledge and all the parts we wanted to show in this particular structure. And I know we do not have time to analyze all the parts of this exhibition. I will try to encourage those of you who haven't visited the exhibition yet to see it. But I want to also show some images while talking about some other challenges as a that a historian faced designing this museum. So first of all, we were repeating the phrase categorically Jewish, distinctly Polish. In this particular museum, we follow the line distinctly Polish, categorically Jewish. So incorporating Jews as part of the local society, and only within the course of the exhibition, within the line, showing in some periods that the Jews had different narrative, that the Jews had to be shown in different narrative in the museum. And as the historians, as a historian myself, I had to make decisions sometimes what to show, what to say, and how to say. And this is the historian's responsibility. And sometimes phrasing the statement that was to appear in on the board was the result of days of quarreling, of days of angry discussions. Because all of the members of the team wanted to have the final word on it. And we didn't, as the team, we didn't want to use too many quotations, and that's why selecting the interpretation was so vital, and it was also mentioned here within the previous discussions. And during the course of preparing, of working on the exhibition, we faced a lot of criticism, and this criticism was constructive and destructive in a sense. And I never realized that the order or the artifacts put on the shelf in the museum can be so important, that the last item on the shelf can be interpreted in the way that I could never think of. And just a few remarks about aftermath, after working on this exhibition. I think as an academic, as the historian who works at the university, I appreciate the experience of working with the museums in many ways, because it selects the knowledge, it allows you to adjust your knowledge to the expectations of the audience, in this case, not only the popular audience or average audience of the museum, but also the students, the other scholars who visit the places like this. And it allows to incorporate the results of the work on the museum into the academic works, into the academic text, clearing the story as it is for the academic purposes. And as it was not enough, also the work on the museum, especially the reception of the museum, was very interesting when the survivors, when the witnesses of the history confronted the result of our work. And I think one of the precious moments that every historian working in the museum could experience was the opening, when the characters, when the people, individuals portrayed in the museum see the place and they said, that's how it was. And I think this is the joy of the historian working on the museum. Thank you.
Thank you again. I can second what Editha said about people who haven't seen this museum going to see it. It's a very impressive and successful museum. Our next speaker is Pavel Maksevich. He and I share Andrzej Garlicki as a doctoral supervisor. He's written a very important book on 1956. He was also one of the co-editors of the two-volume set of essays and documents on Jedwabne, published by the Institute Pamięci Narodowej, one of the most important contributions to this very difficult and ultimately productive debate. And he's now undertaken a very difficult task. He is the director of the museum not yet open to be in Gdańsk on the history of the Second World War. And the theme that he has taken this afternoon is the problems which an academic historian faces in developing a narrative of the Second World War and how one is to incorporate into this narrative the issue of the mass murder of the Jews during the Second World War. Pavel.
Antony, thank you very much. Thank you for inviting me to this very important conference. First, information, just to make more precise what you said in your kind introduction. I indeed took part in a seminar by Professor Andrzej Garlicki, but my supervisor was Professor Marcin Kula. I would like to give a credit to him. I think this is very important to remember it. I would like to share with you my professional experience of the transformation which I had to undergo, quite a painful transformation from a position of an academic historian. Basically, I was trained to write books, to teach students, and I did it for the biggest part of my professional life. But at a certain stage, I accepted the task to create from a scratch the Museum of the Second World War, with a very big, huge exhibition, permanent exhibition, which is supposed to include, in fact, the whole experience of the Second World War, including the political and military dimensions of the war, but of course with the greatest emphasis upon the terror, the genocide, the fate of civilian population. So this is a tremendous task, and it was also even more difficult for someone who belong to the academic community. And so very briefly, in these 10 or 15 minutes, I would like to first address this first point of my talk, how to somehow benefit from the experience of the academic historian in creating the historical exhibition, and how not to spoil the exhibition with the knowledge, with narrow-mindedness in a way of an academic historian. So in my opinion, the greatest challenge was to, and it has to be achieved very briefly, at once in fact, is to go from understanding the history in terms of facts, documents, historical, social processes, into explaining very complicated issues by terms of one single photograph, just 60 seconds of a film, or just one object. And I think that this was a very enriching experience. Also, I think that every historian could benefit from it, and once a historian quits the museum and go back to an academic community, I think that he could have a chance at least to be a better historian. But let me perhaps use more concrete examples how this evolution took place, so how our museum has been created. As Anthony mentioned, this is the ongoing process. The Museum of the Second World War in Gdańsk should be open next year. We already completed the project of a permanent exhibition, but the museum is not open yet. So the first stage of this transformation was writing a very short, a very concise, just 10 pages long, a sort of a outline paper. It was not a scenario, it was much shorter. This was a paper which outlined some basic goals of the museum. Like, for example, emphasizing that the most important perspective will be the perspective of the civil populations, not of the military, not on the other politicians. So it will be that it will be the museum of the Second World War, but not the military museum, but it will focus on the experience of civilian population, and as I said, on the terror, genocide, various forms of terror and genocide against civilian populations. The third point of this very short outline paper was stating that the experience of Poland and East Central Europe should be very important to the permanent exhibition. This experience, which usually is not included to a sufficient degree in most well-known historical museums in the Western Europe or in the US. The next stage was asking more or less, as far as I remember, 40 academic historians from various countries to write for us, for a team who was responsible for creating the exhibition, background papers. So the suggestions what should be included in specific parts of the exhibition, like, for example, concentration camps or slave labor. These were very often very brilliant papers, but now I can say that they didn't have a very concrete impact upon our thinking. It was still too academic, I would say, too general, although it contained sometimes some concrete advice what objects should we seek, what photographs would be most important for particular parts of the exhibition. I would say that the most decisive part of the work on the exhibition and which required the biggest flexibility on the part of professional historians who were at the core of the museum team was the cooperation with designers. We had an open competition and it was a Belgian designing company from Brussels, Tempora, who won this competition. And for more or less 4 years, the team of historians cooperated with designers. And it was a very, I would say, a very difficult, sometimes painful process, especially for historians who had to understand, for example, that 90% of what they wanted to convey in the exhibition is either useless or redundant or perhaps is very clever, very important, but could not fit into the exhibition. So we all had to understand that we will convey only a minor part of all these very wise things which we wanted to say. So this dialogue lasted for 4 years, and we had to transform our historical message, which meanwhile took the forms of very concrete screenplays for each part of the exhibition. We had to transform it into the actual design, into the design projects of particular parts of the exhibition. And in these parts of the exhibition, of course, not documents, not the historical ideas, how we understood them, were the most important, but photographs, films, artistic design, and objects. I would like to emphasize that we decided to put the greatest emphasis about artifacts. We have, of course, lots of multimedia, because this is what people expect now from modern museums, but for us, the core of the exhibition will be authentic historical objects. We'll have more or less 2,000 objects at the permanent exhibition. So what was the final result? The total surface of the permanent exhibition will be more than 5,000 square meters. So this is a very big museum, bigger even than the Pauline Museum. We managed to narrow down the total amount of written words, so I mean the labels, to more or less 330 standard manuscript pages. So in my opinion, this is not so bad, but it happened to some extent at the expense of putting all extra information into multimedia. For us, it was a sort of the place where we could put all the information which was too large, too complicated to put them on this most elementary level of visiting the museum. Still, my greatest concern is that it will be too large exhibition, in a way too academic with too many information, it will be the visitors who will judge it the next year when we open, but still I'm not sure whether I managed to somehow transform myself enough from a position of an academic historian to a creator of a historical exhibition. And now very briefly, I would like to somehow discuss this task of an academic historian, how to create the historical exhibition using perhaps the most important example from our work, how we face the challenge to integrate the story about the Holocaust into the overall story about the Second World War. As you know very well, most museums which deal with the time of the Second World War are either the military museums, like, for example, Imperial War Museum in London, which deals not only, of course, with the Second World War, for example, the Museum of the World War II in New Orleans, which is almost purely a military museum, like, for example, the museums of the Great Patriotic War, both in Kiev and in Moscow. Another type of the museums which deal with the time of the Second World War are the Holocaust museums. The Holocaust Museum in Washington, D.C., the Museum in Yad Vashem, Memorial de Shoah in Paris. We took the task, the challenge of showing various dimensions of the war and of integrating the Holocaust into the story about other kinds of Nazi genocide. And in my opinion, it creates both dangers, but also it gives a very unique chance to explain the roots of the extermination of Jews, its dynamics, the evolution and the radicalization of the Nazi policy, which had a lot to do with the course of the Second World War. In my opinion, many Holocaust museums which for obvious reasons and for justified reasons focus on the Holocaust history, do not include enough of a historical context. And this context is absolutely crucial to understand the way to the Holocaust, the road to the Holocaust. I will give you the examples how we created this section of the exhibition in our museum. This is the largest section of the exhibition devoted to the various kinds of Nazi terror. It starts from the story about the extermination of the Polish elites in 1939, which was probably the first kind of a genocide carried out by the Germans. More or less 50,000 of members of Polish intelligentsia were killed already in 1939, according to the lists which were put together before, even before the war by the Germans. Then we tell the story about the extermination of the mentally ill and physically disabled people, and this is the story which has been neglected for many decades, and very important to understand the road to the Holocaust, because as many of you certainly know, the crews, the personnel who created so-called euthanasia centers in Germany, then went to the occupied Poland and create the death camps for the Action Reinhardt. So this, there is a link, both, let's say, a technical, personal link, a technical link, but also a link in the way of thinking that a certain group of people could be totally eliminated. This is dangerous or redundant and should be eliminated. We also show the extermination of the Soviet prisoners of war in the German captivity. More than 3 million of them were killed, starved to death. So we show the whole landscape of the extermination. And in our opinion, only against this background, the Holocaust, the extermination of Jews, could be understood. And we could understand what shaped the German decisions, because it was an evolution. It was not a program, a project which was ready at the outbreak of the war. There were of course dangers, and I'm quite concerned about the reactions when we open the museum, whether there will be perhaps some criticisms that we somehow lose the uniqueness of the Holocaust. In my opinion, we do not lose it. We explain the road to the Holocaust and its place in the German policy. This example is very important to somehow say at the end of my presentation that we appreciate, as a historian, I appreciate very much the role of designers, but still, what is the most important for the historical exhibition, this is the conceptualization, intellectual conceptualization. And this story, which I tried to convey in a very brief way about how to include the Holocaust into the broader story about the Nazi terror, shows that this is mostly the responsibility of a historian who has to transform its mind, but still has to be an academic historian, because otherwise there is no guarantee that the message would be very precise. Still, it will be the visitors who will judge if it is really clear enough, logical, and consistent. Thank you very much.
Well, no, thank you very much for this very interesting presentation, and we all very much look forward to the opening of the gallery. The next speaker is Victoria Mochalova, the director of SEFER, the Center for the Study for the Teaching of Jewish Civilization at Moscow University. Many people here, I think, have been to the conferences which are organized by SEFER, and she's going to talk about Jewish museums in Moscow.
Dziękuję, drogi Antonie. Znajdując się w ścianach tego wspaniałego muzeum, wcale nie mam zamiaru porównywać jego z muzeami moskiewskimi, a szczególnie w zakresie objętości narracji muzealnej, ze względów zrozumiałych. Historia Żydów w Rosji liczy trochę ponad 2 stulecia i właściwie zaczyna się od rozbiorów Polski. Żydzi nie przyjechali do Rosji, lecz znaleźli się w niej razem z miejscem swego wielowiekowego osiedlenia, co też trzeba brać pod uwagę przy analizie koncepcji muzealnych. Jak pisał Juliusz Gessen, Rosja w drugiej połowie XVIII wieku przyłączyła do siebie obce ziemie, od dawna zamieszkiwane przez zorganizowane masy żydowskie, a więc Żydzi w Rosji pojawili się jednocześnie w wielkiej ilości, a co więcej, pozostając na swoich własnych przez stulecie miejscach. W Moskwie istnieją 3 żydowskie muzea. O bardzo różniących się koncepcjach, powstały trochę w różnych czasach, ale już wszystkie w postradzieckim kraju, bo wcześniej były nie do pomyślenia. I powstały na różnych zasadach, i mając różnych innych organizatorów. Chronologicznie pierwsze z nich powstało w roku 1990, a z powrotem można. Nie, z powrotem. W roku 1998 na terytorium olbrzymiego memoriału II wojny światowej, czy raczej Wielkiej Wojny Ojczyźnianej, jak ją tradycyjnie przyjęte jest nazywać w Rosji, na tak zwanej Pokłonnej Górze. To jest miejsce takie bardzo znaczące, związane z wojnami, zwycięstwami, znane już od, w dokumentach od wieku XIV. Tutaj na przedmieściu Moskwy przyjmowano zawsze z pokłonami, stąd nazwa wielkich gości, zagranicznych posłów i tak dalej. I właśnie tutaj Napoleon oczekiwał w roku 1812 klucze od Kremla. I dlatego tu właśnie obok wybudowano w kolejną rocznicę zwycięstwa nad Napoleonem luk triumfalny. I w 1958 dzięki finansowemu wsparciu obywateli państwa oraz władz moskiewskich udało się założyć tu wielki park zwycięstwa. 135 hektarów to zajmuje. No to właśnie synagoga. Ten park na cześć Wielkiej Wojny Ojczyźnianej. Więc w takim oto historycznym miejscu powstał wielki memoriał żydowski, synagoga i wewnątrz Muzeum Dziedzictwa Żydów oraz Holokaustu. Architekci Moshe Zarchi, architekt izraelski, i Włodzimierz Budanow, rosyjski. Jest to zespół architektoniczno-rzeźbiarski, który obejmuje pomnik zwycięstwa. Właśnie. O, tak to wygląda ten park. Centralne Muzeum Wielkiej Wojny, Cerkiew Świętego Jerzego, memorialny meczet i synagoga z muzeum, a także kaplica pamięci hiszpańskich wolontariuszy, wystawa sprzętu wojskowego i różne kompozycje rzeźbiarskie. Oczywiście cała koncepcja ogólnego memoriału nie mogła nie wpłynąć na charakter Muzeum Dziedzictwa Żydowskiego i Holokaustu, który był założony przez Rosyjski Żydowski Kongres. Oczywiście przy pewnym wsparciu ze strony władz miejskich. To było bardzo znaczące wydarzenie w historii nowej Rosji. W otwarciu uczestniczyli prezydent Jelcyn, prezydent miasta Łużkow, który podarował synagodze zwój Tory. Synagoga została wybudowana według właśnie powiedziałam architektów izraelskiego i rosyjskiego. Dekoracje rzeźbiarskie wnętrz wykonał znany rzeźbiarz izraelski Frank Meisler. To jest stela. Właśnie wnętrze synagogi. Tu zbierają się na modlitwy oraz święta trzy różne gminy. Ortodoksyjna, aszkenazyjska, reformowana oraz gmina Żydów górskich. Ekspozycja muzeum mieści się na przestrzeni galerii oraz piętra podziemnego. Znaczna pomoc przyszła ze strony Państwowego Muzeum Historycznego, Muzeum Historii Religii, największych rosyjskich archiwów. Tam odbywają się w synagodze różne imprezy. I chociaż można powiedzieć, że to muzeum jest pomyślane raczej tradycyjnie, nie ma dzisiaj analogów w Rosji oraz w byłym ZSRR. Ekspozycja składa się z dwóch części. Pierwsza jest poświęcona historii Żydów w Imperium Rosyjskim i Radzieckim, życiu religijnemu i codziennemu, przedmioty obrzędowe, wyroby ludowe, instalacja sztetl nawiązuje do obrazów Szagała. Na wystawie znajdują się, to jest dyrektor Aleksander Engels, znajdują się materiały dotyczące historii Żydów od ich osiedlenia się w Rosji, odzwierciedlające wkład Żydów do kultury rosyjskiej, ich udział w rozwoju gospodarczym kraju, w jego ochronie podczas służby w armii carskiej. Znalazły swoje miejsce w ekspozycji również i tragiczne karty w historii rosyjskich Żydów. Druga część muzeum jest poświęcona Holokaustu. Są tu dokumenty, fotografie, listy rozstrzeliwanych, listy pisane z getta, pamiętniki żydowskich żołnierzy i oficerów, którzy walczyli na frontach Wielkiej Wojny. Jest kronika filmowa z niemieckich zasobów archiwalnych hitlerowskich. Tu brytyjski reżyser filmowy Harry Scott Irwin i szkocki kompozytor i poeta Brian Riddell darują, prezentują muzeum swój film o Holokauście. Ciekawe, że jest muzyka Henryka Góreckiego. W zebraniu muzealnym są też osobiste listy i pamiętniki żydowskich żołnierzy, materiały dotyczące historii żydowskich grup partyzanckich. Specjalna część wystawy jest poświęcona Sprawiedliwym Świata. To jest właśnie sala filmowa. Bez przeszłości nie ma przyszłości, jest napisane na ścianie synagogi. I tym się kierują pracownicy muzeum, prowadzące działalność oświatową i edukacyjną, przede wszystkim wśród młodzieży szkolnej. Tu przy stole prezydent funduszu Holokaust, dr Ilja Altman. Inaczej wystawy, to jest właśnie w tym parku zwycięstwa. Zupełnie inaczej pomyślane Muzeum Historii Żydów Rosji, które zostało otwarte 18 maja 2011 roku. W 2012 roku muzeum zostało członkiem Asocjacji Żydowskich Muzeów Europy. Tu na otwarciu ambasador państwa Izrael, pani Dorit Golender. Jest to muzeum prywatne. jego założycielem i właścicielem jest pisarz, biznesmen i członek Rosyjskiego Kongresu Żydowskiego Sergiusz Ustinow. Od listopada 12 też jest jego dyrektorem, ponieważ Leonid Lifland, pierwszy dyrektor, z powodów zdrowotnych musiał zostawić to stanowisko. Jako swoje główne zadanie organizatorzy obok Ustinowa w muzeum są dwa konsultanci naukowi z Izraelu, obaj historycy sztuki, Hillel Kazowski oraz Borys Chaimowicz. Tak wygląda wnętrze. Naukowy zastępca dyrektora, dr Maria Kaspina, filolog. Za swoje główne zadanie uważają zachowanie pamięci historycznej, opowieść o żydowskiej kulturze. I tradycje. Jest to muzeum znajdujące się w rozwoju dynamicznym. Ma w swoich zbiorach ponad 4000 eksponatów, z których tylko 1000 mogą być prezentowane na stosunkowo niewielkiej wystawie. Muzeum nie ma oddzielnego budynku. Ale kolekcja ciągle się poszerza, a jej dalsze uzupełnienie jest planowane. Ponieważ organizatorzy muzeum nie stawiali przed sobą zadania zwięzłej narracji historycznej, a zebrane eksponaty, praktycznie wszystkie są autentyczne, należą do sfery etnograficznej, kulturalnej, do sfery sztuki. Powiedziałabym, że jest to raczej Muzeum Kultury, Sztuki i Etnologii. Większa część eksponatów jest związana z żydostwem aszkenazyjskim, które zostało włączone do Rosji w wyniku rozbiorów Polski, ale już w maju 2012 roku muzeum otwarło specjalny dział poświęcony historii i etnografii Żydów nieaszkenazyjskich, bucharskich, górskich i gruzińskich. Koncepcja muzeum przewiduje dwa główne działy. Tradycyjna kultura, to jest dział polityki, formy istnienia, wspólnoty, edukacja, filantropia, dobroczynność, religia, dekoracje synagog i procesy historyczne, relacje Żydów do społeczeństwa i rządu, udział Żydów w gospodarce, kulturze. I ponad 200 lat historii Żydów w Rosji to taki łańcuch metamorfoz. I wystawa próbuje przedstawić opowieść o ludziach, którzy pozostali wierni swej wierze i tradycji, a także o tych, którzy zostawili, by stać się częścią kultury rosyjskiej. I to jest przykład, jak muzeum wychodzi, jak muzeum współpracuje z placówkami innymi i robi bardzo ciekawe i wspaniałe wystawy w innych miejscach. To właśnie estetyka sakralności w Bibliotece Literatury Obcojęzycznej. Na pierwszym planie prezydent Rosyjskiego Kongresu Żydowskiego. To jest inny przykład współpracy z innymi instytucjami. Wystawa Gmarcha Tematowa zorganizowana w innym żydowskim muzeum, o którym trochę później. I ta historia, i ta kultura jest mało znana szerszemu ogółowi i społeczeństwa nadal jest ukryta zasłoną mitów. Więc to jest takie zadanie, posłanie. Poszczególne działy, tradycyjne żydowskie życie, cykl życia, synagoga, życie religijne, rzemiosła, żydowskie zawody i tak dalej. To jest właśnie założyciel Sergiusz Ustinow na swojej wystawie. Po lewej Hillel Kazowski, doradca naukowy i główny rabin Rosji Berlazar, ogląda właśnie wystawę tego muzeum. A to już trzeci, ostatni muzeum, znajdujące się w historycznym budynku. To jest pomnik konstruktywizmu autorów Szuchowa i Mielnikowa. To był taki garaż dla autobusów, 25 rok. I po prawie wieku od powstania rosyjskiej awangardy konstruktywistycznej to arcydzieło architektury stało się platformą dla high-tech muzeum w Rosji. Gmina żydowska, czyli Federacja Żydowskich Gmin Rosji w roku 2001 otrzymała od władz miasta ten budynek, który wtedy znajdował się w bardzo złym stanie. Więc historycy w muzeum, no jeden historyk jest tu obecny i zaraz będzie to profesor Benjamin Natans, oczywiście profesor Kirschenblatt też wchodzi w skład Rady Naukowej, ale to już to muzeum żydowskie i Centrum Tolerancji to kompleks kulturalno-edukacyjny, w którym oprócz stałej wystawy są wystawy tymczasowe, centrum badawcze, edukacyjne, ośrodki dla dzieci, czyli to jest wielofunkcyjna instytucja kultury otwarta dla wszystkich. I stała wystawa opowiada historię Rosji od czasów Katarzyny do dnia dzisiejszego. I w odróżnieniu od tradycyjnych muzeów, to muzeum i Centrum Tolerancji są interaktywne. I 12 pawilonów tematycznych, które zostały zaprojektowane przez firmę Ralph Applebaum Associates. Ja po prostu myślę, że dłużej to już profesor Natans, który...
No, dziękuję bardzo. Ale thank you very much. I'm glad to thank you very much again for this very interesting presentation, and I'm glad also that you shortened it. The next speaker is Ben Nathans, a very well-known historian of Russian Jewry. His book Beyond the Pale has been very widely received. He was one of the chairman of the academic committee for this museum, which Vika has just described, and he's now going to describe his role in that position.
Thank you. I'm going to try to be brief, if only as an act of mercy to the speakers who are following me, and for the sake of discussion afterwards. So as my colleague and friend Victoria indicated, I was a member of the content committee that helped produce the academic blueprint for the Museum of Jewish History and Tolerance Center in Moscow. Just a brief word about its location. I do hope some of you will be able to see it with your own eyes. It's located in the north part of the city in an area known as Marienrosha, which was one of the traditional settlement areas of Jews in Moscow already before the revolution, although it has none of the historical resonance of the location of this museum in Warsaw. Unlike some of the others, I thought it would be interesting for me to explicitly compare the Moscow Museum to this one, since for me the most interesting aspect of this entire conference is the discussion about the art of translating academic work into the idiom and language of a museum, and that's really what I'd like to focus on. So they have a lot in common to begin with. Both of them are non-artifact-driven museums. They are interactive. They deploy very advanced forms of technology. They're more story-oriented, storytelling, multimedia using museums than artifact museums, although both of them have scatterings of artifacts which are blended with the more high-tech exhibition technologies. And that is basically where the parallel ends. I want to focus instead on what seem to me some of the striking differences, some of which have come to light for me just since my arrival here on Sunday and the few hours that I've had so far to look at this very rich exhibition at Polin. So to begin with, this was not a public-private partnership that produced the museum. I'm not sure those categories are even applicable to Russia. This was a museum that was the product of an overlapping set of interests on the part of the Jewish Federation of Russia, which is dominated by Chabad, and the Kremlin, specifically Vladimir Putin, who had a strong interest in having a Jewish museum in Moscow. And the overlap had to do with the idea that the possession of such a museum in one's capital was a sign that one was a civilized country, a fully modern country along the lines of the major European capitals that have distinguished Jewish museums. And also in Putin's case, and it really did come from the Kremlin, there was an insistence that this museum broadcast, among other things, the message of ethnic and religious tolerance in the still kaleidoscopically diverse Russian Federation of today. There were many, many dress rehearsals for this museum, and I don't have time to go into all of them, but they began in the early years of the 21st century and really picked up steam once the Jewish Federation of Russia contacted and hired Ralph Applebaum Associates, which is a museum design firm in New York, London, and Beijing. It's the firm that designed the Holocaust Museum in Washington, D.C., the Clinton Library in Arkansas, and various other museums. It was at that point that the project developed what I would call a game plan. The representatives of the Russian Jewish Federation came to Ralph Applebaum with a vague idea of having a Museum of Jewish History in Moscow and a substantial amount of money that had been delivered to them by several oligarchs in Russia. And everybody was operating within the parameters set by the Kremlin. And without the assistance of the Moscow mayor and the Kremlin, we never would have gotten that stunning building by Melnikov and the real estate that came with it. So we worked with a building that was handed to us, and I was hired in 2008 by Ralph Applebaum, and I was part of a committee, the so-called content committee of academics, and I worked with a terrific team consisting of Natan Meir, Oleg Budnitsky, Raisa Levitt Khan, and Jonathan Dekelchen. Another difference is that we were given an absolutely inflexible timeline. We were told at the beginning of 2008, this museum is going to open in November 2012, ready or not. So to me, this was very reminiscent of the Soviet five-year plan mentality, only it was a four-year plan. We had 4 years to go from a garage and a piece of real estate, a lot of money, and nothing else. No curatorial staff, no artifact collection, no kind of specificity about how to partition the timeline that we were given, the last 250 years of Russian Jewish history, nor the space that we were given, 90,000 square feet. And I want to emphasize that if I'm to stay in the time that's been allotted to me, I'm going to have to proceed at the rate of roughly 6,000 feet per minute, which I'm not going to do, but that's to give you a sense of how compressed this is going to be. Now, there was a lot of concern, both on my part and the other members of the content committee, and certainly to the many scholars that we consulted with on individual topics and people, that a heavy hand of politicization was going to be at work in this process. And I have to say that many of the concerns that I had about political interference turned out to basically evaporate in the process, and other issues came up for which I had not been prepared for resistance, either from the side of the Jewish Federation in Russia or from indirectly the Kremlin itself. So for example, the mandate to create a tolerance center, and no one knew what that was going to be or look like, the mandate to create the tolerance center essentially floated in the air and had virtually nothing to do with the actual content of the museum. Those of you who know something about the history of Jews in the Russian Empire and the Soviet Union, and we're filled with experts in this auditorium, know that it's by no means obvious that any version, any interpretation of that history could plausibly culminate in a message of tolerance. And there was a complete disconnect between the work that we did on the museum, on the one hand, and the Tolerance Center, in which we played absolutely no role. I saw the Tolerance Center for the first time when I went to the museum shortly after its opening in December of 2012. So for better or for worse, the high concept that was supposed to govern the museum, and it certainly inspired the sponsorship of the museum at the highest level of the Russian political pyramid, ended up having a certain detached quality from the museum itself. So another difference that really has come to the forefront of my mind after being at this conference and seeing the museum here is that we virtually never pose the question, what is Russian about Russian Jewish history? That was a non-issue for us. And it really hits me now, I think, with full force that the reason why that was a non-issue is that we were dealing with an empire. Whether it was the Russian Empire or the Soviet Empire, there was never for us an agenda of, was this person a Russian Jew or not? We have the convenient term rasisky to indicate something larger than the purely ethnic Russian identity, the purely Russian Orthodox identity. And for us, the potentially vexing question of who's in and who's out, who counts as a Russian Jew and who doesn't, similarly was resolved with remarkably little pain and conflict in an, I would say, a sort of nakedly pragmatic fashion, which was Russian Jews are any Jews who lived in any territory that was controlled by the Russian Empire and or the Soviet Union or its successor state, the Russian Federation, at any time in the history of those polities. And that meant that we were dealing with a moving target over time. As you know, because Poland experienced a smaller version of this, there were radical shifts in borders across the 18th, 19th, and 20th century in the Russian case. And we, in a sense, simply rolled with the punches. And we took as protagonists in our story people who, during their own lifetimes, were subjects or citizens of those various polities. Another contrast, I think, between the Russian Jewish Museum and the Polin Museum where we are today, is that we did want to have a rather strong authorial voice in each of the dozen or so galleries. That is, we assumed that the typical visitor to this museum might more or less know absolutely nothing about Jewish history and about Judaism as a religion. And we felt an obligation not to preach and not to be pedantic, but to provide the building blocks of information and a basic narrative structure, either within which or against which the data, the many images and films and human lives that we presented would easily take on significance. Maybe more than one form of significance, but would not be as raw as if we simply presented quotations, data, and images and expected people to put things together. So as a result, while I wouldn't say there's a meta-narrative governing the entire museum, there are a series of strong thematic thrusts in each of the galleries. And certainly my own personal goal for the museum was to produce the effect in visitors of having their curiosity aroused, of having historical puzzles and dilemmas presented to them in such a way as they would be perceived as inescapable. Like, yes, I really have to confront this problem. This is a compelling issue. And to at least begin the process of giving them the information they needed to start thinking creatively and constructively about those puzzles and problems. We did not expect uniform outcomes, and certainly the viewer response information that we've gotten so far verifies what anybody who's ever published a book and read the reviews knows, which is that there is always going to be a multiplicity of ways of reacting. So let me go through briefly, and without duplicating too much, the images that Victoria already showed, just what the museum looks like in a nutshell, and literally in just a few seconds, maybe a minute or two, so I'm not going to linger too much. So really interesting constructivist building was transformed into a museum after having served for several years as the site of avant-garde art installations in Moscow, and really a destination address in that capacity. Here you see what it looks like from the inside with the very interesting lattice work preserved in the original window sizes. So this is a bird's eye view of the museum, and I don't know if this thing, does this thing have a laser pointer? How do I do that? The top one, okay, thank you. So you enter the museum here, and the first thing that you're supposed to go to is what's called the Beginnings Theater. This is something that was more or less mandated. Even though this is a museum of Russian Jewish history, again, because of the assumption of minimal factual knowledge, we wanted to briefly get people ramped up. How did Jews get to Russia? Who are the Jews? How did they begin? So the Beginnings Theater is it's a surround sound, 4D, very high-tech, pull out all the stops theater, which tells the story of the book of Genesis, essentially, in highly visualized form. And it presents it as a series of stories that it doesn't literally tell this as history. It says these are the stories that Jews learned to tell about themselves. And it emphasizes, again, this is something that you can't take for granted, it emphasizes that the holy scriptures in which this story is captured are common to the three major monotheistic faiths, which are represented in serious numbers in today's Russian Federation. And that's been the case, of course, in its previous incarnations. After you emerge from this 4D experience, you spill out into the migrations area. And this explains, in a nutshell, through a series of interactive exhibits, how the Jews got from the ancient Near East, first to Europe, then to Eastern Europe, and eventually to the Russian Empire. And as was said, the Jews didn't come to the Russian Empire, the Russian Empire came to the Jews. I like that phrase, they woke up one morning and they were subjects of Russia. This table here, it consists of a series of highly interactive zones of information. Next to it is a wall that briefly introduces people to the structure of Jewish languages, especially to Yiddish. So you can touch the elements, the words in a Yiddish sentence and see the languages from which they came and get just a brief, superficial sense of what it means to be a fusion language in a very graphic sense. That's followed by the shtetl area, which I have to say is rather impoverished compared to the one here, because the idea is sort of to get them a brief glimpse of the Polish-Lithuanian heritage and then to launch them after the partitions on the Russian story proper. And again, very abbreviated, there are a series of galleries here that take them through the 19th century, urbanization, modernity, new technologies, the revolution, civil war. I think both the architectural nodal point as well as the emotional nodal point of the museum is here in an area which attempts to combine the story of the Second World War, the Great Patriotic War, and the Holocaust. A very visceral, large screen with footage of the Nazi invasion of the Soviet Union, as well as testimony by not only survivors, and this is something that's, I think, distinctive to the Russian case, but very stark testimony by Jews who participated in the Soviet army. And of course, there were tens and tens of thousands of them. And this is a story that we tell in quite a bit of detail. And this is probably the most richly artifact-driven section of the museum. You emerge here into a remembrance space, to me also not terribly successful in the sense that it doesn't, for me at least, induce a mood of reflection. Rather, it's a series of databases in which you can find names taken from data from Yad Vashem as well as the Russian Ministry of Defense. You can find the names of those who were killed in the Holocaust and the Second World War. I'm racing through details and racing and erasing a lot of details here. After the remembrance space, you go into the post-war era, the Zhdanovshina, the murder of the Yiddish poets, and straight through to the thaw and to the Jewish national awakening and the emigration movement here. And then you spill out into what used to be called the Perestroika and Beyond zone, but which is now being reworked to have a stronger message about Jewish life in post-Soviet Russia today. This little triangle is the Tolerance Center. And there are basically a series of exercises there, completely detached from the historical data in which you've been immersed, to sort of probe your assumptions and attitudes towards ethnic and religious difference. In the hallways here that separate the rows of gallery spaces are a series of information-rich timelines. One of them is a timeline of Russian Jewish history so that you can see the chronology laid out in case that's not clear in your head already and just see what the different chunks of time mean and what they involved. There's also one which is a kind of crash course in Judaism. So we did, in a sense, hive out the information about Judaism as a religion, again, to make clear to people who simply have no exposure to it what it involves, what the ritual objects look like, what the basic texts are, what the rhythm of Jewish time is across the cycle of a year. So, in a nutshell, that's what the museum looks like from above. When you actually enter it, whoops, when you actually enter it, it looks like this. This is the Beginnings Theater. Now, you can see the wraparound, and if you sit in the front row, you're gonna get sprayed with water when the waters are created. Looking as you exit from the Beginnings Theater. That table over there is the Migrations table, which begins the interactivity, and beyond that is the Shtetl area. Here you can see one of the timeline hallways, which contain multiple levels of information, visual as well as textual. Okay, moving right along here, that's the Migrations table. This is part of the Shtetl exhibit, which includes a digital Torah, so you can interact and have translated for yourself the portion of the week, depending on when you visit. It also has a page of Talmud that is digitized so that the different commentaries can come to life, and you can see how visually a page of Talmud is structured as a dialogue over time, or a conversation over time. That's the digital Torah scroll. In each of the various galleries, you have the option of dropping down to a level, a deeper level of information should you choose to do, say, the 30-minute version as opposed to the 5 or 10-minute version of that gallery. It includes a series of short films between 3 and 5 minutes long. You pick up one of the speakers, you put it to your ear, and you can learn about a specific person or a specific topic. Some of the few artifacts are found in the section on Judaism as religious practice. That's that. This is the cafe that we constructed, a sort of reconstruction of an historic Odessa cafe. That's Dubnov sitting there, and that's Vengerov sitting there. I forget who that is. And at each table are a series of key texts, and if you place your hand on the text, information about it comes up. And then there are a series of sort of opinion polls about what you think, where to emigrate to, which political party to join. So it uses interactivity to cultivate the curiosity of the visitors. Here you're in the revolution section. You see the iconography becomes more clearly Soviet, avant-garde, ditto for the section on the early Soviet Union, 1922 to 1939. This is from the War and Holocaust section. You see this gigantic panoramic screen. The presentation of rural bucolic Soviet Union on the eve of the attack features the opening bars of The Rite of Spring, and then bum, 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 comes Operation Barbarossa. It's really, for your senses, it's an overwhelming experience. I take no credit for the choice of music, by the way, which I thought was really inspired. That's one of the testimonies by a veteran of the Soviet Army, and it's bookended by footage of the blockade of Leningrad and other scenes. Here you see some of the artifacts here. These are documents from people who were drafted. You see military medals, various military documents included in that section. We also have an M34 tank, which was designed by a Jewish engineer, which played a crucial role in the Soviet victory over the Nazi army. This is the Remembrance Hall, which again I find is not particularly contemplative, but does contain a lot of information if you want to look up individuals. Post-war, that's Zhdanov himself. slamming down the podium. This is a recreation of the birch forests outside Moscow, the Avrashki forests, where the refuseniks used to gather to play music and talk and console each other. And this is the exterior of the museum at night. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much. I think that, you know, there's been a Polish-German reconciliation, Polish-Ukrainian, Polish-Lithuanian, Polish-Jewish. Unfortunately, whether it's whose fault it is, one can well argue the Polish-Russian reconciliation understanding is still a long way off, and probably it'll have to wait till the end of Vladimir Vladimirovich, but we all hope for it, and we all hope that the... Well, not immediately. So these two papers give us a lot to think about. This is the same community. This is the same issue which was raised in an earlier discussion. I'll move to the last two papers. I'd first like to ask Leah Price from Yad Vashem, a specialist on the Holocaust in Poland, who's going to talk about questions for the historian in the museum.
Relating to the museum of Yad Vashem,
yes.
Which I was a member of the historical staff. First of all, I feel honored to be here, and thank you, Professor Polonsky, for inviting me. I just want to relate to Barbara Kirschenblatt's statement that in the first stage comes the story, and then all the others. Definitely, I agree. Who wouldn't agree? But I'd like to pose some reservations. It's often you have to yield to some constraints or pressures which come up from the ground or from above that twist the road and even disrupt the narrative that we wish as historian to convey. When we at Yad Vashem were working to create the museum that would present the history of the Holocaust, it was clear that the gallery on the ghetto, and it was decided by a steering committee that was above us, headed by Professor Israel Gutman, is well known. And we understood that ghettos is a very Jewish phenomenon, and we have to dedicate a special gallery for the ghettos. So we have to include at least one ghetto that was set up by the Nazis in the Soviet Union, mainly in territories within the 1939 Soviet borders. This was the case since, as historian, we thought that what took place in this area represented a turning point in the process of the Holocaust. We initially chose to present the Minsk ghetto, not Minsk Mazowiecki, but Minsk ghetto, and for several reasons. First of all, it was one of the four largest of all the ghettos, and the largest one on the Nazi-occupied Soviet territory. It was also distinctly due to the long period of its existence in comparison with other ghettos in the Soviet Union, and even into Vilno ghetto from July 1941 to October 1943, with its population consisting not only Jews from the Soviet territory, but also Jews who had been deported from the Third Reich, Germany, and Jewish refugees who fled, ran away from Poland. Furthermore, the Minsk ghetto could serve as a model of the existence of several historical phenomena, ones that were characteristic of all Nazi-occupied areas, such as the mass murder of the Jews, not in camps, but nearby in murder sites, not far from the places they lived, and its cooperation with non-Jewish forces outside the ghetto and the escape of thousands, we don't know the exact numbers, of inmates from the ghetto into the forest and their contribution to the partisan movement. However, when we began to examine matters in great detail, it turned out that there was a lack of visual materials to enable us to present the story of the Minsk ghetto in a comprehensive manner and one that would have an experiential impact on the museum visitor. because the visual materials that were available were not insufficient for this purpose. Consequently, we ultimately shifted out choice to the Kovno ghetto, for which, as we well know, which is well known, there existed considerable visual and experimental, experiential materials from which a worldwide historical narrative could be created. But Kovno is not a Soviet, typical Soviet community. But so in this case, as in most other cases regarding museology, the visuals are the key elements. The question, another question that we had to confront was the audience, the public to which the museum is addressed. This is one of the major concerns of historians, of curators. What is the target public? A local that is national, one that already has knowledge and specific expectation from the exhibition, or are they visitors from abroad that encounter the topics of the exposition for the first time? Yad Vashem's Museum of the Holocaust is visited by tourists from hundreds of thousands, millions a year, from around the world, and by large numbers of Israelis. Most of them are Jews. Basically, the knowledge about the Holocaust that the Israeli visitors brings to the museum is quite different from the non-Jewish visitor. For example, from South Korea or Brazil, who tend to know very little about Jews in general and about European Jews in particular. Furthermore, even Israeli society itself is not monolithic. The State of Israel and Yad Vashem consider it their obligation to make the memory of the Holocaust part of the heritage of all segments of much fragmental Israeli society. For example, ultra-Orthodox, Haredim, Jews. For many years, they avoided the exhibition of Yad Vashem, and David Asaf spoke about it. They consider it as a secular Zionist institute, at least once. However, among the reasons they cited publicly were the photograph, one photograph in the old museum of undressed woman, just before she was shot to death. In fact, and that was the reason, they excused not to come to the museum. In fact, for us historians, the shooting to death of Jews who had been forced to take off their clothes was a widespread, even typical feature of their murder in countries like Lithuania, Latvia, we have from Lipaya a series of such photographs of women, Western Belarus and Western Ukraine. Evidently, from the historical point of view, this aspect of their inability to react, to respond to the shocking violent attack as a result of such humiliation should be stressed. Yad Vashem's new museum took this, the Haredim's sensitivity into consideration, and due to the opposition of today ultra-Orthodox Jews, it was decided not to exhibit these photos. Moreover, after opening the new museum, the Haredim Jews came up with the claim that the appearance of most of the figures of the individuals who were shown in the exhibition are more modern. They should come here to the Gallery of the Shoah here. Men without beards and no sign of the traditional dress, clothes, in comparison with the way that most of Jews, at least in Eastern Europe, looked alike. As a result of the pressure from the ultra-Orthodox Jews, Yad Vashem had to add some exhibits focusing on Orthodox Jews. Another problem, a very sensitive one, relates to the approach to the controversial issue of Pope Pius XII and the Holocaust. If Professor Michman is here, he was involved very much, he's my boss, he was involved very much with this problem. The Museum of Yad Vashem, as well as in the Jewish world in general, the museum referred to the Pope's attitude to the Jews during the Holocaust as controversial. In the wake of a sharp protest from the Vatican, and because of the sensitive and complicated issue, after many mutual discussions with the cardinals in Yad Vashem, it was eventually altered to the response of Pope Pius XII to the Holocaust is controversial among researchers. And so on. Visitors from the Soviet Union, for example, or those who were brought up there, Olim Chadashim, as immigrants, are very critical, and the least to say disappointed, of the fact that May 9, 1945, the Victory Day, now celebrated, is not among the main topics of Yad Vashem Museum. Hopefully this problem has been resolved lately by the opening of a Jewish fighter museum in Latrun. So these examples reveal how we have to face the question of how to present matters to viewers from more than one group and with more than one perspective. From what I've said, my view should be clear in constructing a comprehensive narrative of the Holocaust in regard to some issues. One appears to have no alternative but to compromise and to develop a sensitive approach that takes into consideration pressures, including political ones. Yet I would like to conclude that in this regard, there is not a single solution to such problem. I can add some more, but I think it's too.
No, I'm very grateful. This actually summarizes.
I am considering.
That's
okay.
Well, thank you very much. We've all. These pressures, I think what is interesting about the discussion here is that we've all faced these pressures, and there is no easy solution to how to deal with them. Mm-hmm. If you're writing a book, you can write more or less what you like, at least until the reviewers start to take you apart. But when you're in a museum, you are in a cooperative venture where compromise is necessary. Mm-hmm. Our last speaker is Professor Jonathan Weber, formerly professor at the University of Birmingham, now professor in the European Studies Department at the Jagiellonian University, the chairman of the committee which runs the Galicia Jewish Museum, the author, together with the late Chris Schwartz, of a very moving book, a collection of photographs with a commentary of what is left of Jewish life in Western Galicia, in Polish Galicia. And he's going to talk about Jewish tourism to Poland, the opportunities for new museum narratives to recontextualize Jewish histories. Jonathan.
Thank you very much for for inviting me to speak on this subject. Professor Barbara Kirschenblatt-Gimblett has reminded us, as we will recall, that museums in general, and the Polin Museum in particular, can act and should act as a major agency of social and intellectual transformation. Here in the Polin Museum, this new meta-history of Jewish Poland has been significantly consolidated, offering us now a multi-ethnic historical narrative which is slowly but steadily going to transform how people think about this country and its Jewish history. I don't know whether many ordinary Jewish tourists visiting the Polin Museum will immediately get the point that the exhibition, in fact, frames a new meta-history. But the message will get through, I believe, slowly but surely. I say that because after 1989, it took about one decade for Jews even to think about coming to visit Poland at all. But now these visits have become, as we know, hugely popular. If the Jewish tour groups that come here now still often focus on the death camps, rather than learning about the colossal spiritual and cultural achievements of Polish Jewry over 1,000 years, I am confident that that model will slowly but steadily be transformed as well. What I want to focus on here, though, is what museums in general can offer by way of new narratives for recontextualizing Jewish histories. I put the word narratives and histories in the plural. It's an echo, of course, of what Barbara calls the chorus of voices. Visitors to the Polin Museum will discover a spectrum of interpretations, especially as regards Polish-Jewish relations, and especially during the Holocaust. Now, Moshe Rossman wonders whether alternative histories, competing narratives, or the presentation of historical vicissitudes and oscillations may simply end up confusing the ordinary museum visitor. Maybe he's right, but I think that ordinary museum visitors can often be deeply gratified when they see that the subject that they've come to learn about can be approached in different ways, perhaps each of them with some measure of the truth, even if not the whole truth. Competing narratives challenge people, I believe, to think again about their stereotypes and to emerge from their museum experience feeling that they've had some profound encounter with the subject. In this context, Anthony's asked me to speak about the visitor experience at two museums with which I'm familiar, namely the Auschwitz Museum and the Galicia Jewish Museum in Krakow. I've got just 12 minutes, so I shall be rather brief about each of these two museums and the alternative histories that these two museums present. The Auschwitz Museum now has got 1.5 million visitors a year. It's impossible to say how many of them are Jewish, though Israelis account for about 62,000. The principal purpose of Israeli tour groups to Auschwitz is, as we all know, to consolidate an ethnocentric nationalist narrative which emphasizes the fragility of Jewish life in the diaspora, the historical inevitability of the genocide against the Jews, and the survival of the Jewish people after the Holocaust in the state of Israel. Now, the Auschwitz Museum obviously does not really present that narrative at all. It has quite a different story to tell. During communist times, Auschwitz presented itself as a symbol of Polish victimhood under the fascist German occupation, and the Holocaust was deliberately marginalized. Birkenau was left to rot and steadily became overgrown with vegetation. Now, since 1989, however, the museum has steadily revised this ethnic Polish narrative. I was a member of the International Auschwitz Council for over 20 years, and in that capacity had the opportunity to propose and then implement a number of changes, for example, that the outdoor information plaques would be in Hebrew alongside Polish and English. Although a long overdue new core exhibition at Auschwitz is still in preparation, the fact is that the museum today, the museum guides, the official guides, have moved very substantially to incorporate a Jewish narrative alongside the Polish master narrative, and indeed Birkenau has been cleaned up. The Auschwitz Museum, I would like to say clearly, in that sense, is an excellent example of the wider mainstream trend in the new generation since 1989 to present the Jewish experience as an integral part of the Polish historical narrative. Not often said, but I would like to say it quite clearly. It can be witnessed, for example, in the large official ceremonies marking the major anniversaries of the liberation of the camp in 1945. At the 70th anniversary ceremony 3 months ago, three survivors were invited to speak. Two of them were Jewish, and one of them was Polish. Interesting. They spoke powerfully, even if, in formal terms, to combine historical material with episodic, disconnected fragments of survivor testimony does yield, I think, an intellectual cacophony. However, even if there are contradictions and incongruities as between the two methodologies and rules of evidence, I don't think that people find this confusing. After all, what survivors offer is their personal experience of the historical Auschwitz, what they say Auschwitz was really like. Survivors' accounts are in a different linguistic register and are simply understood, I think, as complementary to the museum's narrative. But there are at least two other kinds of narrative available at Auschwitz. First, the museum's national exhibitions, presenting a mosaic of memories, including a Hungarian narrative, a French narrative, a Sinti and Roma narrative, a Jewish narrative, and so on. And secondly, a humanist universalist discourse, presenting Auschwitz as a universal subject regarding genocide in general, and nothing at all to do with Jews or Poles or Hungarians or Sinti and Roma and their respective narratives. Question: do these competing narratives and the chorus of voices confuse the visitor? I don't think so. I think that if anything, this incoherence, because it is incoherence, demonstrates not only the multidimensionality of the subject, it also, through that multidimensionality, helps to unpack the subversive nature of genocide, which cannot be adequately grasped using just one single narrative. I happen to like the cacophony. The Auschwitz Museum is a cemetery, but it is also not a cemetery. It is a symbol, but it is also a real place and not a symbol at all. The museum does its job correctly by making these multiple narratives available, even if the average Jewish visitor and their tour guides do not normally look for an inclusive or transcultural view. They do what pilgrims do everywhere, namely, they visit only those places and hear only those stories and commentaries which are of interest to them, and they ignore the physical and conceptual spaces in between. Even if they're physically surrounded at the Auschwitz Museum by huge crowds of non-Jewish visitors, remember 62,000 after out of 1.5 million, no contact is made with them. But the important thing, and that's all I want to conclude on Auschwitz, is just to say one more sentence. The important thing is that there are agencies nowadays which do promote multi-ethnic visiting and multi-dimensional programming, and an educated interest in participating in these groups is markedly growing even among Jews. The awareness of multiple narratives at Auschwitz is, I believe, an important new feature of the 21st century realities. So, the Galicia Jewish Museum. 5 minutes. It's a small private institution inside an ordinary pre-war vernacular building, and it opened 10 years ago on a shoestring budget. Not like your place, I'm afraid. It consists of a core photographic exhibition, as well as space for two temporary exhibitions. It's got a cafe and it's got a large bookstore. Okay, I curated the core photographic exhibition, which is called Traces of Memory. Let me make it very clear, it is not at all an exhibition of Polish Jewish history arranged chronologically, not at all. Rather, in line with my own professional approach as an anthropologist, it portrays just the present day 21st century realities using color photographs arranged thematically. The idea is to popularize the subject for visitors and aims specifically in so doing to show competing narratives and indeed the simultaneity of contradictions and paradoxes as they exist today. Of course, the disadvantage of this approach is that by definition, I cannot show Polish Jewish history as such, although I try to rectify this in my captions to the photos, including brief reference to such things as the historical at-homeness of Polish Jews in Poland and moments of anti-Jewish violence. But one great advantage was that I could present the persistence of popular Jewish stereotypes or simplified, mythologized, subjective memories of the imagined past. Why? Because they're part of the present-day realities, and that's why I could include them. And then in my exhibition, I could go on to challenge them and problematize them. The exhibition has got 120 fully captioned photographs from about 50 different places in southern Poland. It's divided into 5 sections, collectively intended to demonstrate, to articulate a multi-dimensional view. The opening section, for example, presents the popular Jewish stereotype that Poland is nothing but a vast Jewish graveyard. So, all it shows in this first section is the shocking sight of ruins and desolation, ruined synagogues, and ruined cemeteries, for example. But the following section explicitly contradicts that theme by showing photos which offer glimpses of the pre-Holocaust Jewish world that can still be seen today, for example, synagogues or Jewish cemeteries that are in perfect condition, not at all in ruins. So by introducing the visitor to a series of different mental landscapes, what the museum aims to do is to demonstrate the profound diversity that the traces of the past still visible in present-day Poland can offer to the visitor. The diversity is clear from the images of the Jewish cemeteries in the exhibition. For example, we show tombstones with inscriptions only in Hebrew, some of them visited by Hasidim and others who believe in the inherent sanctity of this country because of the outstanding rabbinical scholars who lived here. But we also show that there were Polish Jews who did not just live in a Yiddish land, but were also conscious of their Polish Jewish identity because some of their tombstone inscriptions are in monolingual Polish. And there are tombstones with both Polish and Hebrew as well. And we show tombstones marking the graves of victims of anti-Jewish violence. So you can't generalize about what you can see in this section either. There are full of diversities in these simple present-day photos. The third section shows photos of different kinds of landscape settings where local events of the Holocaust took place. These are in the center of the exhibition. In other words, the exhibition's narrative, which again is not chronological but thematic, does not either begin with the Holocaust nor does it end with the Holocaust, something, of course, which the Polin Museum has done as well. What then follows the Holocaust section is a fourth section focusing on the different ways that people here have coped with a difficult past. And this includes, of course, the erasure of memory in recent decades, and also the opposite of that, namely the sustained multifaceted attempts at memorialization made by Poles as well as by Jews. The photos for these first four sections are totally without people in them, symbolizing Jewish absence. But the fifth and last section reverses all that. It consists exclusively of portraits of the wide range of people who are involved as memory makers, scholars, politicians, Holocaust survivors, souvenir dealers, pilgrims, tourists, students, as well as ordinary local people who take part in the massive annual Festival of Jewish Culture in Kraków. Now, altogether, these five sets of photos offer an immediacy representing the conflicting truths and the chorus of voices that coexist with each other today. What they point to is that it is certainly true that in Poland today one can find ruined synagogues, concentration camp memorial museums, and the erasure of the Jewish memory, but it is simply not true that that is all that one can find here. There is also active memorialization, as well as Jewish revival, and a strong sense of Polish nostalgia for the Jewish past alongside attempts at healing. Collectively, these clearly suggest open-ended alternative futures. Open-ended alternative futures. It is precisely the encounter with multiple narratives, including the contradictions, paradoxes, and incongruities that forms the central message of this exhibition, being open for 10 years. Visitor feedback indicates that such multidimensionality is appreciated by visitors as highly instructive and a space for critical reflection. We have received many awards, and TripAdvisor, no less, has recently named us as one of the top 10 museums in Poland. Top 10 museums in Poland. It's a fairly unconventional approach for a museum because there is no fixed interpretative model, but it is based on my belief in the need to be strongly inclusive attuning visitors to the multi-thematic realities by taking them on a present-day itinerary across many kinds of intellectual and emotional terrain. The core exhibition is tiny, occupies just 400 square meters, one-tenth of the size of the Polin Museum. But visitors can easily walk through it in 1 hour and then emerge feeling that they've learned something about this difficult and indeed incoherent, tangled, and chaotic subject. The photos taken by the late Chris Schwartz, who founded the museum, are superb, and it's his aesthetic which is what visitors remember, along with the five very simple, totally accessible messages that we wanted to communicate. And the exhibition ends on an optimistic, upbeat note, namely that even the visitors themselves, by coming to the museum, are themselves memory makers. The museum is a Jewish space hosting numerous cultural events of all kinds, including Christian-Jewish dialogue, etc. It presents a chorus of voices, including the voices of the Holocaust dead, the voices of the Jews who created an outstanding Jewish civilization in this country, and the voices of present-day remembrancers. So, from the modest perspective of the Galicia Jewish Museum, it has been enormously gratifying to see the colossal achievements of the Polin Museum here. I believe there's no doubt now that the new narratives offered by museums here in general will contribute massively to new ways of thinking in the coming generation. Thank you. Thank you.